First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this conference and for giving me the opportunity to present the case of the Greek genocide, which was one of the three ancient Christian populations that lived in the area, a genocide perpetrated by the Young Turks and the Kemalists. Let me start by saying that the Pontic Greeks are an ethnically Greek group who traditionally lived in the region of Pontus on the shores of the Black Sea and in the Pontic Mountains of northeastern Anatolia, a geographical area which now is part of present-day Turkey. Ancient Greeks built their colonies there till the first millennia BC and lived in this area almost for 3,000 years. Till their expulsion during the genocide. The genocide of the Pontian and Asia Minor Greeks was the systematic killing of the Christian Ottoman Greek population carried out in Anatolia during World War I and during its aftermath, namely 1914 to 1922, on the basis of their religion and ethnicity. It was instigated by the government of the Ottoman Empire, members of the Committee on Progress, the then ruling political party, the Young Turks and the Turkish National Movement led by Mustafa Kemal, and included massacres, forced deportations, death marches, executions, and other forms of lethal violence. Apart from the biological destruction, a destruction of Eastern Orthodox cultural, historical, and religious monuments followed. According to various sources, several hundred thousand Ottoman Greeks died during this period. Most of the survivors fled to Greece or to Russia, and after the Treaty of Lausanne and the Exchange of Population Treaty, which was signed in 1923, the rest of survivors came to as refugees to in Greece. The genocide of the Greeks of Pontus as a consequence and the result of the ethnogenesis of Turkey is included in the category of the constituent genocides. We have genocidal extermination of a population in order to create a modern nation state. Now, some historical background. The genocide didn't happen out of the blue. In order to understand the transition from a multinational, multicultural Ottoman Empire to a nation state, it should be emphasized that the Ottoman genocide was the culmination of two historical processes and transformations that had begun many years earlier. On the one hand, there was the famous Eastern Question. In diplomatic history, the Eastern Question was the issue of the political and economic instability in the Ottoman Empire from the late 18th to early 20th centuries, and the subsequent strategic competition and political considerations of the European great powers in light of this question. And on the other hand was the rise of nationalism. The nationalist Young Turks based in Thessaloniki and followers of the pan-Turkism ideology converted their 19th century declarations of citizens' equality, which, which was declared during the Tanzimat period, to the well-known early 20th century slogan, Turkey for the Turks. This ideological fermentation and the prevalence of nationalist currents from the Young Turkish movement, the embrace of social Darwinism, the economic hardship, and the totalitarian way of sultans governing were all combined in the political and military scene with a steady and gradual loss of territory. And this is very important. From 1908 to 1920, the Ottoman Empire was stripped of most of its European, Asian, and African possessions. The loss of the Balkans in particular was a tragedy that had stigmatized the memory of the Young Turks. The bitterness of the loss of Macedonia and Thessaloniki, which had been the birthplace of most of the leaders of the Committee of the Union in Progress, had also been deeply felt. Between 1878 and 1904, about 850,000 Muslims refugees settled in areas that had been occupied mostly by Armenians and other Christians. This uprooting of the Muslim Balkan populations was the turning point in the development of Turkish nationalism from the backdrop of an Ottoman ideology. Their earnest desire to regain their lost homelands and to avenge those who had taken them opened the way to a flourishing militaristic and nationalistic mindset. Already the feeling that their existence and their homeland was at risk began in the 19th century, and by 1895, the fear had been crystallized in the slogan, "The homeland is in danger, vatan tehlikede," for which the Christians had been held accountable. They therefore decided to leave the Balkans and the Arab states and fight in Anatolia and Asia Minor, where they would create the new Turkish state, an advice that the Germans had previously suggested. It is important to highlight the fact that not only were Christians target for being responsible for the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, but they were also considered as unwanted population, as an internal tumor. One of the leading actors of these national cleansings, Kusubasi Esref, had stated that the non-Muslim populations constituted internal tumors that needed to be cleaned, and that such an act was a national cause. Now, the persecution began in 1913 with the Greeks of Eastern Thrace and then continued with the Greeks of Asia Minor. The elimination program included forcible transfers and deportations, economic blockade, massacres and looting. What is important to underline here is that all this had happened before Greece entered the World War I, a fact which Turkish historiography often uses to denounce the charges of genocide. Greece entered the war in during the summer of 1917. What happened to the Greeks of Asia Minor and Eastern Thrace was a precursor to what would follow to other Christians as well. Indeed, Morgenthau, the then American ambassador, reveals that Bedribe, a police commander in Constantinople, told one of the Morgenthau secretaries that the displacements of the Greeks had been so successful that they decided to use the same method in the other Christian nations of the empire as well, meaning the Armenians. One of the ways of extermination was the forced and violent deportations of populations in order to die on the road from hardships. These deportations had not been random, but were rather the result of systematic study of population data. And at the end of my lecture, I will show you some maps to get a better idea of what I'm saying right now. Demographic anxieties shaped the deportations of the Pontic Greek population. Fuat Tundar adequately recorded in his doctoral thesis that the Young Turks elaborated national statistics, maps, and ethnological studies the summer of 1914, which had helped them apply a scientific way to the homogenization policy of Anatolia. Furthermore, Dundar and Taner Aksam both agree that the Ottoman documents reveal that demographic policy had first been used against the Greeks in Western Anatolia and was applied between 1913 and 1914. So first Greeks and then the Armenians were distributed across the empire so that the numbers of Christians in every region would be 10, 5, and 2% or even less than the remaining Muslim population. This was the measure they had in mind for the assimilation of the surviving Christian population from the massacres and the harsh conditions of death marches. In other words, it is now a fact that the deportation policy had been a well-studied action in order to remove and annihilate the Greeks of Anatolia. The then headmaster of a Greek school, Kinigopoulos, affirms the above in his memoirs published in 1919, saying that, I quote, "Since 1916, most men in the Sivas area had either been deported or imprisoned. Women and children were transported to Azizye province, where they were distributed among Turkish villages, so that no more than 5 or 10 of them lived in the same village. Their Islamization was the ultimate goal. It is important to note that the Unionists had planned not only the expulsion, but the resettlement process as well. It is also important to note that the Ottoman authorities endorsed the general evacuation of the provinces only after they had been able to move the Muslim refugee populations there. As soon as the authorities evacuated one village or region, they would immediately then install a Muslim population. Indication of the authorities' lack of intention to allow any returns is provided by the persecution of the Greeks from Gerasun, a small city close to Trebizond, the major city in Pontus, who, once they were displaced and dispersed in June 1917 in Sivas, Ankara, Bolu, and other cities, refugees from the Caucasus were installed in their homes just 2 weeks later. So if they intended to allow the return of the displaced, they would not allow their homes to be occupied. In this way, the authorities achieve a dual purpose. On the one hand, they are displacing the unwanted population, and on the other hand, they are solving the problem of the accommodation of the Muslim refugees from the Balkans. There was no doubt amongst diplomats and missionaries that following the genocide of the Armenians in 1915, the Greeks would face the same fate. A number of consular documents revealed the plan for the displacement of Greeks in the interior, as they stated in their report that the fate of the Greeks would be the same as of the Armenians. There are numerous documents that we see this statement repeated all the time, that after the Armenians, which were massacred in 1915, the Greeks will follow. So there are many testimonies according to that, like a testimony from a diplomatic and missionary records. For example, a statement that the Austrian consul of Trebizond made to the prefect of the Black Sea Mission, Father Lorenzo, is very revealing in terms of this. In his personal diary, after describing the exile and massacres of the Armenians, the prefect noted that many Turks had told him that once the Armenian question was solved, the Greeks and then the rest of the Christians would be taken care of. The same conclusion was also outlined by the German priest Johannes Lepsius. Quote, anti-Hellenic and anti-Armenian persecution are two phases of one and the same program, the extermination of the Christian element in Turkey, end of quote. Moreover, a Turkish diplomat member of the Young Turks had stated, quote, it is a pity that in our glorious times, our ancestors did not completely exterminate the Christian race from the empire. In this way, we would have secured peace, end of quote. Taner Aksam and Fuat Tundar had revealed through their researches on the Ottoman in the Ottoman archives that a dual mechanism was used in order to annihilate the Christians from the empire. Official telegrams followed mass massacres and atrocities at the end of 1916, suggesting the operation of this dual mechanism and the dual nature of Talat and the committee. On the one hand, official telegrams were issued to protect people and property, while contrary actions were being executed, such as the initiation of the exile, executions, deportations of people to Ankara, Sivas, even so far as Aleppo, Kharput, and Malatya. We speak now, these distances in kilometers are approximately 200 kilometers or even more. And after their deportations and immediate replacements in their houses by Muslims. In cases where there had been no installations of Muslims, houses and villages were being burned. Now, in order to characterize a crime as genocide, the perpetrator's intent on executing the target population is needed. Often in his biography, Talat notes that what happened to the Greeks had not been centrally designed. But several testimonies reveal this intent to exterminate the Greeks. I will give only some examples. First of all, it has been preserved in the Austrian diplomatic archives that Talat himself revealed this intent in a personal conversation with the Austrian agent on January 31, 1916. He said that, I quote, "I see that a need appears in Turkey for getting rid of the Greeks, as previously we have done with the Armenians," end of quote. Moreover, in a highly confidential report sent by the Austrian consul Kwiatkowski from Samsun on November 29th, 1916, it is stated that the local Mutasarif, the governor, had told him, quote, "We need now to be done with the Greeks. I sent today in the environs part of the gendarmerie with the order to kill every Greek they would meet on the road," end of quote. Aksam believes that Talat's attempt to hide his knowledge of the massacres was based exactly on this dual mechanism. On one hand, there were written orders to governmental authorities to handle the Greeks gently. And on the other hand, there were oral orders to paramilitary groups organized by Teskilati Maksousa, which was this secret organization, Teskilati Maksousa, to do the killings and the looting. Aksam also believes that the same dual track mechanism can also be seen in the boycott actions. Talat's intention to cleanse Turkey from all Christian elements was revealed also by their ally, the German ambassador Wagenheim, in a report he sent on June 17, 1915 to the German Chancellor Holbeck. The diplomats appear to have been surprised at Talat's revelations, as he openly spoke about the issue of the Christians' expulsions with them. The telegram reads as follows. Quote, "Talat Bey explained without hesitation that the government wanted to use the World War as a pretext so as not to allow foreign powers to intervene, so as to clear the country from the inner enemy, meaning Christians of all confessions," end of quote. Now, despite the fact that a large part of the Pontic Greek population was exterminated by massacres, international reactions to the Armenian massacres that culminated in 1915 forced the Young Turks to adopt a new strategy of extermination. So the extermination was not only achieved by massacres, but by a series of measures that were implemented, leading to the extermination of the target population. Accounts in diplomatic documents report that until 1916, much of the Hellenism of Pontus and Anatolia was destroyed through its forced entry into the labor battalions, but also through politically driven displacements and deportations, which had been as deadly as massacres. It is important to note that deportations and displacements were deliberately organized to cause annihilation. This practice, particularly in the case of the Greeks, gives an extraordinary alibi for the deaths to leadership of the Young Turks to deny their culpability, which is still used by deniers today. The use of deportation as an effective mechanism for the cleansing of Christians was revealed by Talat in Morgenthau. Morgenthau wrote about one of his meetings with Talat. Quote, "He told me that the Union in Progress Committee, the political party, had carefully considered the matter in all its details and that the policy which was being pursued was that which they had officially adopted. He said that I must not get the idea that the deportations had been decided upon hastily. In reality, they were the result of prolonged and carefully deliberation," end of quote. So even though deportations had the same effect as that of the massacres, they give the perpetrator the advantage of the argument of being innocent. Hannibal Travis writes, "Genocide by deportation facilitates denial of the crime. few could deny that genocide by direct killing of a racial or religious group would constitute a massive crime. In recent work, I have argued that genocide may take place by means of deportations into circumstances of life, bringing about large-scale premature deaths from hunger, disease, exposures, and homelessness. This specific practice of deportations falls under the Article 2 of the Convention, which reads as follows, quote, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part, end of quote. Now, let me give you some examples of how deadly were these deportations. The first major systematic catastrophe in the Western Pontus area of Samsung occurred in 1916, and these events, as we will see, were well designed. First of all, according to a telegram sent to Janik is the area of Western Pontus, the authorities were asking to know how many Greeks had been moved from the particular province, where they had been sent, and how many of them had remained. Unfortunately, we haven't found the answer in the archives, but what we do know is that in the months that followed, the persecution and violence had escalated. And here is a significant aspect regarding this escalation of violence and deportations in the Samsung region. And this should be further highlighted. One of the leading actors of the genocide of both the Armenians and the Greeks was the CUP Central Committee member Bahaeddin Sekir. Bahaeddin Sekir was the responsible figure, the responsible person for the genocide on the Armenians in Erzurum area. So there is no coincidence that the deportation process of the Greeks became more systematic only after Bahaeddin Sekir reached the region in December 1916. After his arrival, people were deported from Samsung, from Giresun and Amasya. This is major cities in the Pontus area. The looting and the destruction of the deportees' villages followed after. The Ottoman central government was well informed regarding these facts, and in a cable to Janik on February 26, 1917, Talat demanded that, quote, an investigation be undertaken and the results reported regarding which villages were burned and destroyed up to now in the course of bandit raids, end of quote. Indeed, with the arrival of Bahaeddin Sekir, the disaster becomes systematic. Between June 1916 and February 1917, massacres and displacements escalated. Only in Giresun, 88 villages were destroyed, while 33,000 people were displaced during the winter. The ambassador of Austria in Istanbul is revealing in terms of the atrocities that were taking place. And I'm reading the telegram as it is. Quote, 11 December 1916, Greek villages were plundered and got burned. The inhabitants were driven out. The next day, 12 December 1916, on the outskirts of the city, villages are burned. 2 days later, 14 December 1916, entire villages are burned together with schools and churches. Some days later, 17 December 1916, in the area of Samsung, 11 villages were burned. The plundering continues. The villagers are manhandled. 31 December 1916, about 18 villages were totally burned, 15 partially. About 60 women were raped. They even looted the churches. So we see in this telegram that day by day, systematically, the Greek villages and the Greek population is massacred, and the Greek villages are plundered. Similarly, earlier the same year, it had been ordered to evacuate shores of Kastamonu region, Sinop, Kerje, and its surroundings, Al-Ajam and Ayandik. That means the city I just read means that the whole part of the shores, the Black Sea shores, were ordered to be evacuated from Greeks after the arrival of Bahaeddin Sekir. There are many more telegrams and examples, like in Samsung. For example, in Samsung, during December 1916, 80 richest and of 80 of Samsung's richest and most affluent citizens were put in prison. And the next day, without any trial, they have been executed. For example, another telegram from the German ambassador, Mitrinek, reads as follows. In Sinop, the operation lasted 4 hours. The Greek population amounting to 4,500 people was transferred partly to Boyabat and Kastamonu and partly to Turkish villages in the vilayet. Now, let me give you some examples on how effective this method of deportation was. Regarding the deportations and the long exterminate death marches, Catholic missionaries and several diplomats were convinced that they didn't occur out of military reasons and that the displacement denoted deliberately and deliberate and certain death. One of the main examples cited was a report sent to Cardinal Gaspari on March 20, 1916 from the apostolic delegate in Vienna, Cardinal Scapinelli. He states the following, I quote, one might consider that the deportation is a milder form of punishment than killing. Indeed, but the first differ not much from the last, and that instead one can escape the general massacre, can hide or escape to the mountains, the prospect of survival for the displaced are extremely low. They treat people like cattle, walking weeks and months in different directions of their destination, while to provide them with the necessary food is the rarest of cases. So the poor succumb to mass starvation and epidemics. When they arrive at their destination, there is no accommodation for them, but they are led to a new destination and then again in another, so that they never rest. In other cases, families disperse, and since men are usually separated from the women, and because the latter are entirely dependent from their lives from husbands, hunger and threats lead women to Turkish homes, children Islamized by individuals or as war orphans, the Islamized through state structures. Now there are several other documents. I will skip them because of the time, the limitation of the time. Just to give you some examples in percentage of survivors from these deportations. For example, from the 13 deportees from Tripoli, only 800 survived. From 700 deportees from Tepekoi of Pulandzaki, taken in 1916, only 232 survived. And according to Metropolitan Germanos reports, from the province of Samsung, 10th of those deported to the Ankara Vilayet are still alive today. And the entire population of the Samsung and Ilyaskoi districts are gone. Sungurlu, which is a place where their destination was, has become their grave. Now, let's touch upon another question, which is used very often by the Turkish historiography, that the deportations happened due to military reasons. Now, another issue that arises from the Young Turks policy is that even if we accept the logic of military necessity behind the persecutions, certain questions remain. Why did the authorities didn't exile only the men, but included in the measures women and children as well? What was the military reason for that order? Hans von Wagenheim, the German ambassador at the time, did not think that the deportations were imposed out of military reasons. But the ultimate goal of the Turks was a definitive riddance of the indigenous Christians who had been seen as internal enemies. This is obvious in the archives, in the diplomatic archives. No one is believing the idea that the deportations happened out of military reasons. There is another, for example, the example of the Austrian consul, Kwiatkowski. He stated that the measures had not been imposed by any kind of military reasons, but had served political purposes instead. And I speak of the German and the Austrian consuls, who were allies with the Turkish. And this is also important. The Austrian ambassador Balavicini had the same opinion. I quote, "It is obvious that these displacements are not currently dictated by any military reason. Their only aim is to promote malicious political expedience." Moreover, as the US ambassador Henry Morgenthau wrote, Enverin Talat Pasha had assured him that women and children would be exempted from the measures. However, the government did not intend to allow these deported from the coastal areas to return to their villages, since, as we said already, it planned to install Muslim refugees into their homes. Now, I will skip some parts. And I will close this, and after that, if I have the opportunity, I will show some maps. So the purpose of this presentation here was, apart from giving some historical data and information, the purpose was to show that the plan of extermination of the Greeks of Pontus was not a byproduct of war or a series of spontaneous but of well-studied acts of massacres and deportations of populations in conditions that would inevitably lead to extermination. As such, it is implied that these events fit the definition of genocide, which the 1948 convention describes as the organized massacres or other acts endangering the life of the target group with the intent of extermination. To Roger Smith, this exact intent applied in the case of the Greeks in Pontus, as he writes, and I quote, "One needs to look at intent and consequences. And in the cases of the Ottoman authorities, the intent is clear as well as the consequences. The Christian minorities of Turkey were largely destroyed from 1913 to 1923. And Hannibal Travis further corroborates, I quote, absent governmental intention to exterminate the Christians of the empire, it would be nearly impossible to explain how the massacres, rapes, deportations, and dispossessions of the Armenian, Assyrian, and Greek Christians living in the Ottoman Empire at the time of World War I could have taken place on such a vast scale. How could such a remarkable degree of coordination and common purpose in slaughtering civilians, ravaging women, orphaning children, and stealing money and property have emerged without organization and direction from above?" And with that, I will close here. Thanking you once again for this opportunity. And if it's possible, I would like to share 2-3 maps. I don't know if I can do it. Okay. Now, the idea was to deport the Greeks from the source of Black Sea to the interior in order to, you see here the main cities, Trabzon, Kastamonu, etc., etc. Can you see the map? Okay. And the idea was to deport them 30 or 50 kilometers to the interior in order to avoid any Pontic Greek men to collaborate with Russian forces or other allies forces from the shores of the Black Sea. But what happened was the following. Here with the red, can you see it? Here with the red, you see the route of the deportees. They started with the cities, the major cities in the shores of the Black Sea, but they continued into the interior and they walked 200 or even 300 kilometers into the interior. And in some cases, they even had also not you see in these two maps, they went back and forth without any destination. So the idea was to exterminate the population. And that is the reason also why they decided to have these deportations during winter in order to have the weather also as an ally in order to exterminate them. So thank you very much.